actually believe that more dynamic writing like that is going to become more more prevalent. And and I know that BMC, for instance, has been doing some interesting thinking along these lines. I think I'll be very interested to see how that develops. I'm actually here, though, to talk not about things that are quite that exciting. I'm here to talk about what I think was referred to yesterday as killer plumbing. I myself don't like the phrase. It makes me think the toilet might explode. But I am talking about killer plumbing. I'm talking about two projects. One of them is a CrossRef project, and the other is a project being run by ORCID, and I'm involved with both. It was originally going to be two separate talks, but we have decided to sort of jam it into one, so it is very much an update. And I am going to be assuming that you are at least familiar with a little bit of the background of each project. The first project I want to talk to you about is a project that we've been working on for a number of years, and certainly a project that I've been hinting at for many years, and that is CrossMark. It's an optional service being provided by CrossRef. And in case you don't remember what CrossMark is, and in case you are getting confused by all the different products that we have that start with the word cross, I thought I'd give you a very brief reminder of what it is, and this sort of plays a little bit to Daniel's previous talk. We have this notion that exists in the industry that articles are completely static, that once they go out the door, that's the end of the publisher's responsibility for the article, and that there's very little that happens after this process. And of course, if we think about it for the least bit of time, we realize that isn't true. This is really driven home to me, and forgive me, anybody from OUP who's here, because they hate it when I show this, but this was really driven home to me many years ago when I was sitting in the OUP lobby and I looked at their bulletin board system and I saw this notice, which if you can't read it at the back, says, product recall important Oxford Handbook of General and Adult Nursing has been recalled. And I thought, wow, we've been putting content online for, you know, close to a decade, and we have created an elaborate system to make sure that citations are persistent, and yet we're issuing the, you know, old analog recall and slips effectively. We don't have a mechanism for alerting researchers to important updates to content. And of course, there are all sorts of things that we deal with daily. And they're an important part of the value that we add, actually. We curate, we steward our data, we steward the content that we publish. And so if we discover that something has gone wrong, and it is a rare event, thankfully, but when we do, we have methods for dealing with it. We issue erratum, corrigendum updates, enhancements, and those are the kinds of things that we deal with in the journal space. There are all sorts of specialized things that you find out that different disciplines do, whether it's things like, like trial updates or things like that. And you find all sorts of different update mechanisms. And then, of course, in the monograph and books world, you have all sorts of different things happening too, including things like new editions. We also know that, one of the things we've been focusing on at CrossRef is providing tools for the publishers to detect fraud, to detect plagiarism, things like that. And these things, when they are discovered, and again, I have to emphasize, they're not hugely popular, but when they do happen, they're very important to deal with. Things have to be retracted and things have to be withdrawn. And we know that increasing competition in academia seems to be leading to this escalation in fraud, in plagiarism and other things. And so we're also, I think, seeing an increase in retractions and things like that. So what is CrossRef? The elevator pitch is it's a system designed to let you identify content that's being stewarded by the publisher. And more importantly, it actually provides functionality for the researcher. By clicking on this, the researcher can be informed in a standard way that will work across publishers who are using the CrossMark system, whether content's been updated, where the update resides, the nature of the update, whether the copy is being maintained by the publisher, and then also it will allow you to record some other metadata that might be useful to the researcher in trying to evaluate the content. But the basic gist of CrossMark is that we want to make sure that researchers are aware when there are important changes. So how does it work? Well, this is actually, and this is part of the status update, this is actually a live site now. The Institute, IUCR, which Daniel actually just pointed out, has been one of the first to start implementing CrossMark on their website. And if you look at this article, you will see that the CrossMark logo is up there on the right. And simply if user, and by the way, if this were the PDF, the CrossMark logo would be on the PDF and it would work in the exact same way. But what the user can do is click on the logo, and when they click on the logo, they get this standard dialogue that tells them, actually, there's been a correction issued for this article. It gives you a link to the correction. And if you follow that link, it will, of course, just take you to the correction. Now, one of the things I've been doing is I always show the HTML version of this. The real use case for this is with PDFs with content that's been downloaded and squirreled away to someone's hard drive. Because, of course, this is what researchers do. When an article comes out, they download it, they stick it in their hard drive, they use it with their you know, PDF management system and so on and so forth. And they rarely think, wow, I better go and check on this again. I better see whether this content is still current. And this system will work on PDFs the same way it does in HTML. One thing I want to do is take you back to the dialogue again, right, this thing that I showed you earlier, because there's another part to it as well. And this is an important part, and it's one that we hope publishers will take advantage of. And I know Fred Diller, who's in the audience, will talk a little bit about possibly ways of taking advantage of this. But you'll notice that there are two tabs on this dialogue, one that says status and one that says record. The record tab's actually an optional tab for publishers. They can fill out the record if they want, but it's a place where they can list any optional metadata that they want about the system. And so in this case, if you click on the record tab, what UICR has recorded is, well, the name of the journal, the content type, that it's a research paper, that it has supplementary materials, the copyright information, and then some information about the peer review process, that it is indeed peer reviewed, and the method of peer review, and then some other stuff down there about the publication history. But the truth is, this is a place where publishers can experiment, where they can put other kinds of data. And the point of it is, in addition to being useful to the researcher, is to give the researcher other reasons to click on the CrossMark as well. Because you're not always going to have updates to articles, but you do want to give them useful information about the article, possible useful non-bibliographic information. So, for instance, you might want to put in that section funding disclosures, conflict of interest statements, publication history information, you know, locations of deposits, registries, peer review process used, whether it's been checked for plagiarism, license types, clinical trial numbers, all of this kind of stuff. All these kinds of things are things that people are beginning to experiment with in CrossMark and the CrossMark pilot. And this gets us to the status of CrossMark. So CrossMark we've been talking about for a long time, and we actually have a pilot running, and the system that you saw was part of that pilot. And we've got about a half a dozen researchers signed up, and they're loading CrossMark data into the CrossRef system, and they're starting to show the CrossRef logo on the on landing pages, and we're beginning to measure what kind of traffic that generates, and to make sure that the logo is actually working, and that researchers understand it, and that it's not conflicting with other elements of the website. And as we do that, and as we close down this phase, the next phase will be to start actually applying CrossMarks to the PDFs. And we're doing that last because, of course, once you do that, you can't take it back, right? Once there are PDFs out there with the CrossMark on it and people can click on it, they're out there for good. So we want to make sure all the back-end stuff is working properly and that it's going to scale properly as well. So the pilot's going on, and we should see it rolling out in anger in the end of Q1 and the beginning of Q2. You'll see a lot more people displaying it. And another thing that we're doing, and I have to emphasize, we're actually not talking to Google. This is a plugin that I wrote, but we are talking to third parties, including some search engines. Microsoft has been quite interested about ways that they can integrate this information into tools. So for instance, you may very well want to be able to see when you do a search, which articles are actually being stewarded by the publisher so that you know that you're getting the most current version of it. You may want your bibliographic management tools, whether you're using Zotero or EndNote or Utopia documents, to be able to tell you automatically when articles have been corrected or updated, or even whether they cite things that have been corrected or updated or withdrawn. So we're very interested in working with third parties to make sure that they get the CrossMark functionality integrated into the system. So if there is anybody here who's interested in joining this, and I encourage you all to, I mean, I think that this falls into the category of, you know, one of the fundamental value propositions of publishers is that we steward content. We should be emphasizing this. We should provide a uniform, standard way for researchers to be able to assess the current status of the documents that we publish. I encourage you to do so. The rules are pretty simple. First of all, participation is optional. You don't have to join it, even if you're a CrossRef member. Participants maintain their own content. They agree to keep CrossMark metadata up to date. They adhere to the logo display guidelines, and we've got a variety of different ways in which you can display the logo that should be adaptable to most people's needs. And they have to have a policy page that explains what their policies are in regards to issuing corrections, retractions, withdrawals, and things like that. And they have to link to it off of the page. And then finally, anything with a CrossRef DOI can have a CrossMark. And of course, what does it cost? Not much. So it's 20 cents per current. For current content, and backfile content is 2 cents, and we define backfile content as, current content as anything published within the past 2 years. So, you know, it's interesting, I think, particularly to see reactions to this. I've been going out and doing road shows, not just to publishers, but to librarians and researchers. We did quite a lot of user testing with researchers as well. And once they understand what the system is and they see its utility in identifying updated content, they get quite excited. And a lot of people might have missed this, but Ivan Aransky and is it Andrew Marcus? They run Retraction Watch, and they recently had an opinion piece in Nature. It came out just before Christmas, so maybe a lot of people missed it, but it talked about this issue of retractions and publishers and whether, you know, and publishers having standard ways for dealing with them and being transparent about this. And one of the things that they did is that we introduced them to CrossMark. They talked about CrossMark as being a potential solution to a lot of the problems that they're seeing with inconsistent treatment of retractions and corrections in the publishing world. So it was quite an, we were excited about that. It seemed like a little bit of an endorsement, but of course they're being, you know, they're waiting to see how it gets implemented. So we encourage you all to sign up. So as I said, this is, I'm doing a sort of a schizophrenic thing here. I actually wear two hats these days. I'm going to move on to the ORCID update, and I should inform you that one of the things that's been true over the past 6 months or so is that I at CrossRef have been seconded to the ORCID effort, which is, so I've been the interim chief technology officer for ORCID for about the past 6 months. And that's going to probably be extended for a little while into the new year, because we're just reaching a critical phase where we're going to actually be launching software, where we're hiring staff, and we want to make sure that transition goes smoothly. ORCID, as you know, is this effort to create effectively unique identifiers for researchers. And I am going to skip the rationale for this, assuming that you all have a pretty good idea of why we need identifiers for researchers. We need to be able to unambiguously identify researchers give them credit properly for all sorts of different exercises, which I'll talk about. And it's very hard to do so, and it's getting harder to do so as research output increases and as we get more and more publishers, particularly from emerging developing countries. So we're going to do this by issuing unique identifiers, and we're going to try and get this identifier basically integrated as early as possible in the production cycle, you know, preferably when, you know, graduate students first start looking at publishing, possibly even undergraduates. We want them to get an ORCID. We want them to use this ORCID when they're interacting with all aspects of the scholarly communication cycle. So, you know, we believe that in the end it's going to actually help just about every party in the scholarly communication cycle. And at this point, I've got to emphasize something because a few people mentioned ORCID yesterday and they referred to it sort of in the same breath as CrossRef, which is understandable because CrossRef has been heavily involved, but they've also referred to it as a publisher initiative. And it's not a publisher initiative. It's actually a joint initiative between publishers, between researchers, between funding bodies, and between institutions. So it is actually a very, it represents all of the big stakeholders in the scholarly communication process. And the reason that's important to emphasize is that you may also remember that years ago, CrossRef was investigating whether CrossRef alone should launch a system. And one of the major conclusions that we came to in looking at whether or not CrossRef should launch a system was that CrossRef could launch a system, but it wouldn't work. And it wouldn't work because it wouldn't have the involvement and active participation and therefore the trust engendered by the other critical people in the scholarly communication process. So ORCID effectively was a sort of an attempt to say, well, look, if we can't do it within CrossRef, we have to create an organization that actually represents all of those constituencies, and that's ORCID. So the researcher, of course, is the primary player in this. We need to get buy-in from them. If ORCID doesn't save them time, if ORCID doesn't make their lives easier, it will fail. And we all accept that, and so we're doing everything we can to make sure that this isn't just another chore given to researchers, that it isn't a burden, that it actually saves them time, that it actually makes them more efficient. Universities are critical to this because, A, they are in a position to actually help us seed ORCID, that is, jumpstart it with information that they have about their faculty members. They can also urge their faculty members to sign up. They can also, for instance, start the process of signing up graduate students and undergraduates as early in their careers as possible. Scholarly societies can also play a role in driving ORCID uptake. Funding agencies can make the process of applying for grants easier, can make the processes of finding out what their grants have funded easier. ORCID is going to be a fundamental tool for them as well. And finally, publishers, of course, there are all sorts of ways in which publishers can use this system. And this goes back to stuff that I think Nick and Mark Ware were talking about yesterday. You know, we know that research is increasingly interinstitutional, interdisciplinary, international, and we need an identifier system that transcends national, institutional, and disciplinary boundaries if we're going to really capture an accurate picture of what scholarly output is. And so we're you know, very interested in, well, publishers should be very interested in this, and they see this as a fantastic way of making their processes more efficient and of their being able to be more accurate in doing things like identifying reviewers and potential conflicts of interest and all sorts of things like that. So again, this is all serves to emphasize that you know, one of the questions that we legitimately get asked when we present about ORCID is, you know, why is ORCID going to work where other systems have failed? And our answer is severalfold, but we emphasize, A, that we're being run by all of the various different constituencies, right? So, so one of the big issues that people have had with past identifier systems is trust. If the system is run by someone who's not accountable to the constituency, there's been low trust. Similarly, because there's been low trust, there hasn't been any effort to integrate those identity systems into the researcher's workflow. So we're hoping and we expect, and we have actually quite a bit of commitment on the part of institutions, funding agencies, and publishers to make sure that ORCID is tightly integrated into their manuscript tracking system, grant tracking systems, and so on and so forth. And so this gets me on to sort of the meat of the thing. I'm going to fly through a few of these slides here because they're kind of, they're all things that you can look up on our website. And they're mostly sort of things saying, hooray, people are taking us seriously. But we have large international uptake. We have a good representation from a variety of constituencies. The board is representative of these constituencies. And we're also working with other identifier systems to make sure that the ORCID system actually integrates with them. The system that we're developing and the system that we're putting out here is what we're calling a self-claim system, and I'll get into that in a bit. But what I want to emphasize is, at the moment, because this is, after all, an update, is this timeline here. This was 2011 to 2012 here, and I'd like to sort of drag you down. We've got some really important things that are happening here. First of all, we have what we call the phase one build of the platform. We're actually in the midst of developing the first iteration of this platform. We've actually released code, API code, which I'll talk about in a little bit, and we're in the process of also hiring staff. So the expectation is we're going to have staff on in the first quarter, and at the end of the first quarter, we're going to be able to deliver that new staff software that is close to being launchable. And I say close to being launchable, and I want to explain a little bit about why I say that. And I'm not trying to hedge too much there. I'm just trying to set expectations properly. Before I do that, I've got to talk a little bit about identity systems and talk about different kinds of identity systems. We're all familiar with self-asserted identity systems. These are the kinds of things where you can basically sign up and you can say almost anything you want about yourself. You see them also all over the web. If you sign up for Twitter, if you sign up for OpenID, you're basically making an assertion about your identity. The other kind of identity system we're very used to is this kind in the middle, organizationally validated identity, where somebody else is saying, yes, you are a citizen of this country, or you have permission to drive a car or whatever. And then the third kind of identity that we often see, and more so now, is what we call socially validated identity. That is where your identity is effectively, the credibility of your identity is established by other people confirming things that you make public. So in LinkedIn, right, other people are saying, yes, I know this person. Yes, I worked with this person. Yes, you know, they were good to work with. In Stack Exchange, people will say, yes, this person knows what they're talking about. The code that they're pushing up there is actually of good quality. Ultimately, ORCID plans to combine all three of these different identity systems, kinds of identity systems. But at first, we're focusing on this phase one identity system. All right? And we're in the process of building this phase one identity system, which is focused on self-asserted identity. So this basically is a fairly familiar concept to people already. And then phase two will have more to do with organizationally validated identity and socially validated identity. So we're here at phase one. And what we're doing is we're taking code that was donated to us from Thomson Reuters. It was the basic code for the researcher ID system, but they donated it to ORCID. We, in turn, have taken that code and, working with Semantico, we've been cleaning it up. We've been making some changes to it that we know we need to make. And this is a list of the changes. I'm not going to go through them in detail, but you can go and find them on our website. But some fundamental changes to the system. And then most importantly, we're taking that code and eventually we're going to open source it. We're going to make it available to everyone. So the Semantico team has been helping us do this, and we've been meeting a few milestones, the first of which is that we have released an API. And this is a critical thing for you, this audience in particular, to know about, because one of the messages that we got was that in order for this to take off, it has to be tightly integrated into the manuscript submission process. And in order for you to do that, you need, your developers, your techies back home, need to be able to use the API as early as possible. So we've actually released the API, even though we have no data, so that your techies at home can start integrating ORCID into your manuscript tracking system now. So the one message I have for you, the biggest message I have for you, is go back and beat on your techies. Please, get them to start looking at this. Get them to start integrating this into their system. And basically, it will allow you to do some of the standard things that you're going to want to be able to do. Import an ORCID record into your manuscript tracking system. Update an ORCID record with information that you might already have about a researcher. But the documentation has all been published, and you can actually go to GitHub, download the code, and try it. Now, that's pretty abstract, and that's pretty back-end, so I've got gratuitous screenshots just to show that we are, in fact, making progress, and I'm just going to run through these things. But basically, this was running on my laptop earlier. We have the ORCID code. We'll be probably making a first release of it sometime within the next month or so, but finally, we're going to release the code at the end of March. So that's basically an ORCID update, and I'm sorry, it just went a little bit over, but I'm happy to take questions if there are any.
Thank you, Geoffrey, and sorry you had to make it a race against time. Any questions? Yes, please, Buzz. Buzz.
Bastraup, Elsevier. I thought the CrossMark bit was really interesting, and my question is, do you have already any information whether most publishers will put the, say, the CrossMark bit of a paper outside or within the firewall containing the original article?
Well, they have to attach it to the DOI, so the CrossMark itself, well, first of all, the CrossMark is going to go with the PDF, so it's going to go outside of the firewall to begin with, right? But the information itself, we want people to be able to, you know, go to, so it's got the same limitations as DOI. People have got to be able to get to the thing that the DOI points to, right?
So let's say that if I would buy a single article for $30, and most publishers allow you to kind of download that article for about 24 hours, then you have the article on your desktop, on your machine, that would, if I hear you correctly, mean that you wouldn't be able to access any CrossMark updates, let's say, a few months later. You would have to repurchase the article again.
Well, so, obviously, if a person subscribes to it, that's not an issue, right? Because they can go and get to it. But I do think you've raised an important issue that's been raised before by Ivan Aransky, which is that what do you do with corrections and updates? Do you put them behind the firewall? Do you charge, you know, $35 for an error? It doesn't, you know, in a lot of cases, that kind of stuff doesn't make sense. So I think that that policy, we're not making a statement about that, the CrossMark. We're not, there's nothing in the rules or regulations about using the CrossMark that makes any statement like that. But I do think that one of the things publishers are going to find is that, you know, as they emphasize that this is a role they play, they do issue corrections and updates, they've got to decide on how, you know, what the accessibility is going to be for them.
Okay, and second question, the CrossMark data, will that become available for some kind of bibliometric analysis?
So the CrossMark data, which remember is optional. Sorry. So the CrossMark data will be, the CrossMark, just that section, which is optional, will be released under a CC0 license so that people can make use of it. The reason we're doing that is that we want to encourage places like search engines, tool manufacturers, and so on to incorporate that into their things with as little barrier as possible, right?
Okay, thanks.
Okay. We have one last question over here. Because we have to watch time, so I hope you can both keep it brief.
Mm-hmm. Nice try.
Jan Burkert from Danish Science Editors. I think the last presentation is a really good thing. For instance, when people are married, they are changing names, and,
yep,
and by this system we can find that two different names is the same person.
Yes.
But I think that probably a problem. I'm from Denmark, and the laws is very strict in Denmark, so don't place your servers in Denmark. So my question is, do you have found out about there are some legal problems around the system.
So I'm going to try and do this very briefly. So one of the things is that if you look, if you go to ORCID.org, I encourage you all to do that. We have a list of 10 principles that we itemize. One of them is that the researcher has control over the privacy settings of their profiles, right? So they can hide any elements of their profile other than the identifier itself. They can hide it. They can either hide it completely, or they can say, I only want to share this with particular parties. The reason we did that is because we know, that that's considered generally privacy best practice, but also because it deals with some of the issues that you raise about sensitivity, about people keeping, about privacy in certain countries. The other thing to emphasize is that we're trying to be very selective and restrictive in the element set that we collect. So we're not, you know, there's no real reason for us to collect sensitive information. We're trying to collect information about the public scholarly record, right? You're not going to see us collecting social security numbers or things like that that just have no relevance to the record. So we're being very careful about that. I hope that answers it.
Thank you very much, Geoffrey. Excellent talk.